We all love the thought of a trip away. In fact, some of us that are mesmerized by space and the planets would love nothing more than a little break away to another planet apart from Earth. We guess it would have some good points, no traffic jams for a start. Let's assume that somehow we had managed to find a way to reach the planets in the solar system and people had learned to breathe in space without the aid of special equipment. If Elon Musk has anything to do with it, this may happen sooner than we imagine. But for now, let's look at just how long humans would be able to survive on each planet. Let's start with Mercury. The Mercurian world is one of extremes. Temperatures of 700 Kelvin on the side exposed to the sun, yet some areas are never exposed to sunlight and are as cold as deep space. If you're lucky, you may be able to survive on Mercury for just under 2 minutes, but only if you stood in the perfect spot and held your breath. Scientists do not believe there has ever been life on Mercury. The atmosphere is almost non-existent. It doesn't protect the planet from the harsh radiation of the sun or radiation from space, nor does it trap heat and provide a breathable atmosphere. Mercury is inhospitable and sterile. In order for life as we know it to exist, Mercury would need to have temperatures that allow liquid water to remain on its surface for long periods of time. But the temperatures on Mercury extend from just above absolute zero when the surface is shadowed to 700 Kelvin when it's in sunlight. Liquid water just can't exist in that kind of environment. But maybe Venus would be better, as it is the closest planet to Earth. Unfortunately not. In fact, you would be very lucky to survive a second on this planet. Venus is sometimes called Earth's twin because of its similar size and structure, but the planets are very different in other ways. Most astronomers feel that in the future it would be impossible for life to exist on Venus. Today, Venus is a very hostile place. It is a very dry planet with no evidence of water. Its surface temperature at 900 degrees Fahrenheit is hot enough to melt lead. And its atmosphere is so thick that the air pressure on its surface is over 90 times that on Earth. Even the spacecraft which landed on Venus only survived for about an hour before being crushed and melted. Venus is made up of a central iron core and a rocky mantle, similar to the composition of Earth. It has a thick, toxic atmosphere filled with carbon dioxide, and it's perpetually shrouded in thick, yellowish clouds of sulfuric acid that trap heat, causing a runaway greenhouse effect. It's the hottest planet in our solar system, even though Mercury is closer to the sun. With or without the aid of special equipment, this is one planet that you would not be able to visit. Now, let's take a look at Mars. How long could we survive there? The answer to this one is probably for as long as you can hold your breath. With a radius of 2,106 miles, Mars is the seventh largest planet in our solar system and about half the diameter of Earth. Its surface gravity is 37.5% of Earth's, which dramatically lessens how much heat the planet can trap near its surface. Surface temperatures on Mars can reach as high as 70 degrees Fahrenheit and as low as minus 225 degrees Fahrenheit. But on average, its surface is minus 81 degrees Fahrenheit, a full 138 degrees colder than Earth's average temperature. The primary driver of Mars' geology is its atmosphere, which is mostly made of carbon dioxide, nitrogen, and argon. By Earth standards, the air is preposterously thin. For example, the air pressure atop Mount Everest is about 50 times higher than it is at Mars' surface. This would make it an unbreathable atmosphere for humans. On top of that, the wind breezes can gust up to 60 miles per hour, kicking up dust that fuels huge dust storms and massive fields of alien sand dunes. Though water ice abounds under the Mars surface and its polar ice caps, there are no large bodies of liquid water on the surface. Taking all this into consideration, we think Mars is another planet crossed off the travel list. Jupiter has a long history of surprising scientists, but we don't think it will come as a great shock to know that this planet is definitely out of the question for your next holiday. For one thing, you wouldn't be able to land on Jupiter, given that it is a great big ball of gas. If you were to jump on it, you would just descend into nothingness until you reached the core, where you would be crushed in less than a second by the pressure of the planet's layers. Fifth in line from the Sun, Jupiter is, by far, the largest planet in the solar system. The mass of Jupiter is 318 times as massive as the Earth, and more than twice as massive as all the other planets combined. Its familiar stripes and swirls are actually cold, windy clouds of ammonia and water, floating in an atmosphere of hydrogen and helium. Jupiter's iconic Great Red Spot is a giant storm bigger than Earth that has raged for hundreds of years. Compasses would really work on Jupiter due to the fact that it has the strongest magnetic field in the solar system. Astronomers think the magnetic field is generated by the eddy currents, swirling movements of conducting materials within the liquid metallic hydrogen core. This magnetic field traps particles of sulfur dioxide from the Io moon's volcanic eruptions, which produce sulfur and oxygen ions. Together with hydrogen ions originating from the atmosphere of Jupiter, these form a plasma sheet in Jupiter's equatorial plane. Just like Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune are enormous balls of gas. Saturn is the sixth planet from the Sun and second largest planet of the solar system in terms of diameter and mass. If compared, it's easy to see why Saturn and Jupiter have been designated as relatives. From atmosphere composition to rotation, these two planets are extremely similar. In Roman mythology, Saturn was the father of Jupiter, king of the gods. The most common nickname for Saturn is the ringed planet, a nickname arising from the large, beautiful, and extensive ring system that encircles the planet. These rings are mostly made from chunks of ice and carbonaceous dust. They stretch out more than 12,700 kilometers from the planet, but are only a mere 20 meters thick. Saturn gives off more energy than it receives from the Sun. This unusual quality is believed to be generated from the gravitational compression of the planet, combined with the friction from a large amount of helium found within its atmosphere. This planet also has the fastest winds of any other planet in our solar system. These winds have been measured at approximately 1,800 kilometers per hour. It's also the least dense planet. Made mostly of hydrogen, it has a density which is less than water, which technically means that Saturn would float. The layers of hydrogen get denser further into the planet, eventually becoming metallic and leading to a hot interior core. The gas and ice giant known as Uranus is a fascinating place. The seventh planet from our Sun, Uranus is the third largest in terms of size and fourth largest in terms of mass, and one of the least dense objects in our solar system. The temperatures at the cloud tops on Uranus averages minus 375 Fahrenheit, which makes it the coldest planet in our solar system. This is due to the fact that, unlike the other large planets, Uranus actually gives off less heat than it absorbs from the Sun. While the other large planets have tremendously hot cores, which radiate infrared radiation, Uranus's core cooled down to the point that it no longer radiates much energy. After Saturn, Uranus is the second least dense planet in the solar system. This low density has an interesting side effect. Despite the fact Uranus is 14.5 times as massive as the Earth, its significantly lower density means that you would not only experience about 89% the force of gravity, assuming you could stand on Uranus's cloud tops. This planet has powerful zonal winds within its atmosphere that can reach up to 900 kilometers per hour and can generate anticyclonic storms like Jupiter's Great Red Spot. The third most abundant component of Uranus's atmosphere is methane, which is what accounts for its aquamarine color. There are also trace amounts of other hydrocarbons, such as ethane, acetylene, methyl acetylene, and diacetylene, all of which are believed to be the result of methane interacting with solar ultraviolet radiation. There are confirmed traces of water, ammonia, carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, and hydrogen sulfide within the layers of Uranus's atmosphere. And due to the extreme cold, they are suspended in an icy state. When it was first discovered in 1846, Neptune became the most distant planet in our solar system. But then, in 1930, Pluto was discovered, and Neptune became the second most distant planet. But Pluto's orbit is very elliptical, and so there are periods when Pluto actually orbits closer to the Sun than Neptune. The last time this happened was in 1979, which lasted until 1999. During that period, Neptune was again the most distant planet. But after Pluto was demoted from the status of planet and therefore defined as a dwarf planet, Neptune has once again become the most distant planet. It's also the smallest of the gas giants, with an equatorial radius of only 27,764 kilometers. However, it is the densest gas giant. Neptune is a ball of gas and ice, probably with a rocky core. There is no way you could actually stand on the surface of Neptune without sinking in, but if you could, the force of gravity pulling you down is almost exactly the same as the force of gravity you feel walking here on Earth. The only difference is you wouldn't stop sinking. Neptune is also another extremely cold planet in the solar system. Temperatures can dip down to minus 366.6 degrees Fahrenheit, which means that an unprotected human being would flash freeze in a second. Taking all this into consideration, we think the only place to live a long life would be the planet that we live on, our very own planet Earth. What do you think? Let us know in the comments and please like this video if you've enjoyed it. If you want to see more videos like this one, then subscribe to Brain Impact for more. Thanks for watching.